Hi everyone, Omores here. Today we are flipping the script. You've seen me run classic GPUs like the 3DFX Voodoo 3 or early AGP cards on something as modern as a socket 1700 motherboard. But what if we go in the opposite direction? Can we take a modern, super powerful graphics card and slap it into a motherboard from the late 90s? Well, in theory, yes. PCI Express was designed to play nice with the PCIe standard created back in 1992, and that compatibility goes both ways. Normally, we use adapters to run all the PCI cards in modern PCIe slots, because let's be honest, who's really going to try to slap an RTX card into a Pentium III rig? But here's the thing, the spec does allow it. A PCIe card should work in a PCIe slot if we can physically connect it and there is a bridge chip behind the scenes. So today we're doing exactly that, taking a modern GPU and forcing it to run on a motherboard straight out of the Windows 98 era. Of course, there is one massive bottleneck, bandwidth. But how bad is it, really? Before we dive in, huge thanks to Brilliant for sponsoring this video. If you've seen me mess around with old systems or newer ones, whether it's reviving Windows 98 or adding more cache to a 486 motherboard, you already know I'm not just about making things work. I want to understand why they work or why they don't, which, let's be real, happens a lot with these experiments. That's why Brilliant works so well for me. It feeds my curiosity with interactive lessons that actually make sense. It's built for minds that love to think things apart and truly understand how they work, and in the process it helps you become a sharper thinker and a better problem solver. Also, everything is broken into bite-sized challenges, so it's easy to make progress even if you got only a few minutes a day. Plus, there are a lot of topics to explore, whether you're into math, physics, computer science, logic gates, signal processing, probability, neural networks, or want to understand the tech behind AI, they've got you covered. So check out brilliant.org/omores. Scan the QR code on the screen or hit the link in the description. You'll get 20% off an annual premium subscription and a 30-day free trial to explore everything Brilliant has to offer. This whole idea started after I saw a Facebook post featuring a seriously cool retro rig. A K6 3 Plus CPU overclocked to 660 MHz. Paired with an FX 5950 Ultra AGP card. Well, that thing scored nearly 5k points in 3DMark 2001, which looks like a world record for a Super Socket 7 motherboard. Then I replied, challenge accepted. But then I thought, well, wait a second, can I actually beat that? So let's find out. First, let's take a closer look at this PCIe to PCI adapter. It uses the PLX8112 chip, which is a common choice for this type of adapters. It's a unidirectional chip, meaning it only works from PCIe to PCI. There are bidirectional or reversible chips out there too, like the Pericom PL7C9X130. Which can operate in either direction, depending on how it's configured. Here's a great example, an awesome Voodoo 5 5500 card from SDZ Mods using the PL7 chip, configured to run in an MXM slot, which is basically just a PCIe slot. On the flip side, here is an NVIDIA GT610 in PCI format, using also the same PL7C chip. One thing I still don't totally get is why this adapter doesn't come with a power connector, especially since adapters for using PCI cards in PCIe slots do have power connectors. A standard PCI slot only delivers up to 25 watts, while a 16X PCIe slot can push up to 75 watts. That's why I used only PCIe GPUs that have their own power connectors. But I also tested an NVIDIA GT 1030, a card that draws up to 30 watts at full load, but in a PCI slot it won't be fully utilized, so it's likely pulling only around 10 watts, making it safe to use without a power connector. Another advantage of low-profile cards like the GT 1030 is that they actually fit in a standard ATX case even when using a PCIe to PCI adapter. Regular GPUs, though, get about 2 cm taller with this adapter, so they won't stay within ATX standards anymore. Basically, the video outputs end up hitting the case frame. Anyway, for testing I used an open frame ATX test bench and simply removed the back panel to mount the GPU. I also wedged a PCI sound card and a couple of floppies in between to keep the GPU almost vertical. I know it's not pretty, but it gets the job done. I actually started testing with a single slot PCIe NVIDIA 7900GS. The same card I've shown here before. It runs great in Windows 98, assuming you've got the right patches installed. At first, everything went according to plan. The system booted up without issues using a PCIe card, and I went straight to a fresh Win98 installation using the original disk. The installation went smoothly, just as expected. Since I used a DVI output, both the pause screen and everything else were upscaled to full HD, which was a first for me on a Socket 7 motherboard. And speaking of motherboards, I used an Epox MVP3 G2. This is an ATX board with USB and PS2 ports. Definitely not the typical SuperSocket 7 board, which usually comes only with an AT keyboard port. I've got a bunch of those. For the CPU, I used an AMD K62 running at 500 MHz. This model was released in 1999, and by early 2000s, they were dirt cheap, under 50 bucks, and some motherboards were even cheaper. I know this CPU isn't exactly the best choice for a record-breaking SuperSocket 7 setup, but since the NVIDIA 7900 is about twice as powerful as the FX 5950 Ultra, I figured it would be good enough. Turns out it wasn't, not the CPU itself, but the whole setup. No matter what I did, I couldn't get the drivers to install. It seems like the BIOS can't allocate the necessary resources for any GPU sitting behind a PCI to PCI bridge managed by the PLX 8112 chip. This isn't just a Windows 98 issue. I saw the same problem in Windows XP, and it wasn't limited to NVIDIA cards. ATI cards had the same problem. So, in the end, I couldn't break any world records with my SuperSocket 7 setup, but I'm not giving up just yet. There are still other Super 7 chipsets out there, like the Aladdin 5 or 7 or even the SYS 530. They might work better with these PCIe to PCI adapters. I can't say for sure, since all the Super 7 boards I have all use VIA chipsets. Next, I switch over to Socket 370 platform, which, like Super 7, was also introduced in 1998. The motherboard is a generic model made by DFI. It comes with an Intel i815 chipset, released a bit later in 2000. That's the same year Intel launched the Pentium III 866 MHz Coopermine CPU, which is also powering this build. For graphics, I went with a NVIDIA GTX 980, one of the best cards you can run under Windows XP, aside from TI and some Titan models. If this works, we're killing two birds with one stone. First, we'll likely score one very respectable 3D mark result for a Coopermine Pentium 3. And second, we're absolutely setting the world record for the lowest GTX 980 score in 3D Mark 2001. Because honestly, who pairs a GPU this powerful with a Pentium 3? And when I say powerful, I mean this thing can easily push 150k points in modern systems. But now it's about to face the ultimate bottleneck. Good news, this time I actually managed to install the drivers. In fact, I knew it would work even before running the installer. Windows XP had already initialized the GPU using its built-in VBE driver, and the desktop looked sharper right away. On the SuperSocket 7 board, XP could only display the GPU in 16 colors VGA mode, and the Bliss wallpaper looked like melted plastic. So how bad is it to run a GTX 980 on a Pentium III while being stuck with the PCI bus limited to just 133 megabytes per second? Well, the overall score is pretty bad, I mean terrible for a GTX 980, but even though the card is bottlenecked by both the CPU and the PCI bus, it still manages to score better than any top card from 2001. And we use that here as a reference because we are using 3DMark 2001. Those top cards would have been something like a GeForce 3. I have a Ti 200, which is about 20% slower than the flagship Ti 500, which cost around $400 back in 2001. Well, my GeForce 3 Ti 200, it only managed to score 4.3K points while being able to complete all the 3DMark tests due to pixel and vertex shader support. So I guess that's it for today. Thanks to Brilliant for sponsoring this video. Stay tuned for more. I've got something big coming up next. Omores out.